Hello and welcome to Byju's IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. On the front page of the Delhi edition, we have an article that deals with the topic of Asiatic lions. But before we look at this article, first let us understand the habitat, the range, the distribution and the conservation status of Asiatic lions and the threats faced by it. See, the Asiatic lion is a majestic animal belonging to the cat family, and it is the only member of the cat family that is known to live in groups known as prides. Because the other members of the cat family, such as the tiger, the leopard, the clouded leopard, etc., they are known to be solitary creatures. Whereas Asiatic lions are known to live in groups known as prides, which includes the male and the female lions and as well as the cubs. The habitat of this magnificent wild animal can be found in tropical and subtropical areas where we come across vegetation such as open dry deciduous forests, tawny forests, dry scrubland, savanna vegetation, etc. Historically, the range of this animal was spread across Middle East and South Asia. It was known to be found in substantial numbers in today's Saudi Arabia, Iran, parts of Turkey, Syria, even in parts of the South Caucasus and the Central Asian region, and as well as in the Balochistan region of Iran, Afghanistan and Pakistan. And it was also found across India. Within India, its range stretched from Bengal, that is today's West Bengal and Bangladesh, and it was found in large numbers in Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Haryana, Gujarat, Punjab, and as well as in parts of Bihar. Over the years, the population of this animal has been destroyed around the world as a result of excessive hunting and poaching, and today its population has been restricted to only one habitat, that is the protected areas of coastal Saurashtra in the state of Gujarat. The Gir Protected Area Network or the Gir Conservation Area is the only wild habitat of the Asiatic lions in the world, and it can be found in the Saurashtra region of Gujarat. This protected area network or the conservation area includes the Gir National Park, the Gir Sanctuary. It also includes the Panya, Mithiala and the Girnar Sanctuary. Today, the biggest threat faced by the Asiatic lions is not hunting and poaching, because their population is quite well protected and conserved in the Gir Conservation Area. But the biggest threat faced by the Asiatic lions is that their entire wild population is restricted to one single place in Gujarat. So this leaves them vulnerable to natural calamities such as epidemics and forest fires. A major forest fire in the region can wipe out the entire population. Similarly, a major outbreak of an infectious disease can wipe out the entire population. In fact, in 2018, the Asiatic lions faced such a threat. A couple of years ago, the Gir Conservation Area witnessed the outbreak of the CDV or the canine distemper virus. This virus, which is known to be highly contagious and fatal to the Asiatic lions, ended up killing around 36 lions in the Gir Conservation Area. But fortunately, the outbreak was brought under control thanks to the efforts of the forest department, the conservation groups and the local community. Apart from this, the Asiatic lions are also threatened by religious pilgrimage in the region. There are around 3 major temples in the Gir Conservation Area, and since every year thousands of people visit these pilgrimage sites, the environmental threat faced by the Asiatic lions increases substantially. Then another threat faced by the Asiatic lions in the Gir Conservation Area is the presence of large number of open wells. Since the region is largely dry and arid, there are a number of open wells, and every year a number of lions are known to fall into these wells and die as a result of drowning. Then of course, just like any other wild animal, the Asiatic lions are also threatened by hunting and poaching, habitat destruction, and more importantly, habitat fragmentation. The habitat of the Gir Conservation Area has been fragmented as a result of a few highways and a railway track which passes through the protected region. So these are the various threats faced by the Asiatic lions, but their threat level increases substantially because their entire population has been restricted to one single location. If you look at the conservation status of the Asiatic lions, they have been listed as endangered on the IUCN Red List as a result of this high threat level. Then under the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species, Asiatic lions have been placed under Appendix 1, which prohibits their international trade. Then under India's Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, they have been listed under Schedule 1, which makes their hunting and poaching a criminal offense. Now, coming back to this article on the first page, it refers to a recent census of the Asiatic lions that was conducted. This census has registered a record number of lions, especially in the Gir National Park and in the agro-pastoral landscapes of coastal Saurashtra surrounding the conservation area, and a total of 674 lions have been recorded. The census has shown that there has been a substantial increase in the population of the Asiatic lions over the last 5 years and as well as over the last 3 decades. From a population of just around 284 lions in 1990, its population has jumped nearly 3 times to 674 as per the 2020 census. So this significant increase in the population of the Asiatic lions is a result of the conservation efforts of the Government of India and the Government of Gujarat. The significance of this successful conservation effort can be gauged from the fact that the Prime Minister himself has tweeted about it. The 2020 census has shown that over the last 5 years, the population of the Asiatic lions has increased by nearly 29% and the area of its geographical distribution has increased by around 36%. The success of these conservation efforts can be attributed to a number of factors, but the biggest credit should go to the participation of the local community in these conservation efforts, thanks to the involvement of the local community by the State Forest Department and the Ministry of Environment and Forest in the conservation efforts. Especially the involvement and the participation of the Maldari community has been critical in the conservation of the Asiatic lions and its habitat. See, the Maldaris are basically tribal herdsmen who have been settled in the Gir conservation area. Historically, the Maldaris were a nomadic community found in parts of Pakistan, Rajasthan and parts of Gujarat. But over the last 4 decades, they have been resettled by the government in the Gir conservation area and they have been playing a key role in the conservation of the Asiatic lions. Being tribal herdsmen, the Maldaris take up the rearing of various cattle and other animals, and they are the only community that has been allowed to carry out grazing inside the Gir conservation area. So the resettled population of the Maldari community plays a key role in assisting the forest officials and the conservation agencies in protecting the habitat of the Asiatic lions and as well as in tackling their hunting and poaching. Along with community participation, the usage of modern technology such as radio collars, GPS-based tracking, camera traps and drones has enabled the scientific management of the habitat. These conservation efforts have also increased the prey base, increasing the availability of food for the lions. Apart from this, the State Forest Department and the Central Ministry of Environment have been proactive in managing man-animal conflict incidents. And by taking adequate precautions and by providing timely compensation, they have mitigated the impact of these man-animal conflict incidents. Then finally, the timely import of vaccines by the State Forest Department helped in containing the outbreak of the canine distemper virus in 2018. So as a result of all these conservation efforts, the population of the Asiatic lions has increased substantially, and this has been brought out during the latest census. Next, we have a column on page number 6, which evaluates the proposal of Donald Trump to turn the G7 into the G11. But we have recently covered this topic in detail on the 4th of June. So kindly go back and watch this analysis and you can go through this column once. So let's move on to another column from page number 6, which evaluates the importance of public healthcare, especially in developing countries. Say, it is a well-known fact that accessing private healthcare facilities is very expensive, and as a result, out-of-pocket expenditure increases, thus making quality healthcare unaffordable and inaccessible. This is very true for developing countries, especially for countries such as India. See, the COVID-19 pandemic has exposed the shortcomings of India's public healthcare sector. In the coming months, we are going to require at least a few thousand or maybe a few lakh hospital beds. And we would also require advanced healthcare facilities such as intensive care units, ventilators, etc. But a large proportion of these healthcare facilities are available in the private sector, and there is a critical shortage of it in the public sector. So the abundance of advanced healthcare facilities in the private sector and their shortage in the public sector has exposed the inequalities and the divide of India's healthcare system. And hence the writer says that In a developing country or in any country, health services cannot be left to the private sector alone, and hence there is a need to promote public healthcare. In order to understand why India's public healthcare system has such severe shortcomings, we need to look at the trajectory that India's public healthcare system has followed over the years. See, post-independence, just like any other developing country, India had a different set of priorities for its public healthcare system. Initially, India was focused upon building its primary healthcare system in order to cater to the basic healthcare needs of the population. And this approach has led to the neglect of secondary and tertiary healthcare systems over the years. In the initial years, just like any other developing country, India was focused upon expanding its immunization program in order to bring more and more people under the cover of vaccination. It was focused on reducing its maternal mortality rate and infant mortality rate by investing heavily in maternal healthcare and pediatric healthcare. Over the years, India has tried to focus on battling common infections such as tuberculosis, polio, etc. So over the years, most of India's investments in public healthcare has gone into these priority areas, leading to the neglect of other areas such as secondary and tertiary healthcare. While investing in these priority areas is justified for a developing country such as India, what cannot be justified is the extremely low level of investments in the public healthcare sector even today. Over the years, India's investments in healthcare has almost stagnated, and it stands at just 1.3% of India's GDP. The writer says that it is this low level of investment in public healthcare that makes India unprepared to deal with a pandemic such as the COVID-19. As we discussed, there is a widening gap between public healthcare and private healthcare facilities, and this makes access to quality healthcare very expensive and unaffordable in India. In a country of the scale and size of India, its investments in public healthcare happens to be one of the lowest in the world. And along with this, the poor utilization of available resources affects the quality of healthcare in the country. Upon this, the lack of accountability, corruption, and the lack of regulation in the public healthcare sector has resulted in a severe shortage of hospital beds, ICUs, ventilators, and other advanced healthcare facilities in the public sector. The low investments of the government in the public healthcare sector also affects the availability of skilled manpower in public hospitals, because specialist doctors who are poorly compensated in the public sector, they take up attractive positions in private hospitals, leading to critical shortages in the public healthcare sector. So this gap or vacuum in quality healthcare created by the public healthcare sector has been filled by the private sector. Because over the last 2 to 3 decades, India's rising middle class and the increasing purchasing power of India's upper class has created a demand for quality healthcare, especially in the urban areas. So on the one hand, you have a section of India's population, that is its middle class and upper class, which does not seek healthcare from the public sector due to its low quality. And instead, it is willing to pay for quality healthcare. And this demand has led the private sector to establish state-of-the-art super specialty hospitals that are concentrated predominantly in urban areas. But on the other hand, a majority of India's population that continues to remain poor cannot access such expensive treatment facilities, and hence they have to remain content with the low quality services provided by the public healthcare sector, and there is no question of them accessing the high quality services provided by the private sector. So as a result, the gap left behind by the public healthcare sector has been filled by state-of-the-art specialty hospitals in urban areas. But on the other hand, in rural areas and in the poor neighborhoods of urban areas, the gap has been filled by unqualified doctors, clinics and nursing homes with questionable credentials, and by doctors who claim to practice alternative systems of medicine. So this wide disparity in accessing quality healthcare services in India leads the author to conclude that access to quality healthcare in India is dependent on one's income. So the wide income divide in India between the rich and the poor translates into a divide in accessing quality healthcare as well. Since the public healthcare sector has failed to fill the gap, the void has been filled by the private sector, making quality healthcare more expensive and unaffordable and inaccessible. In this context, the writer stresses upon the need to increase government spending, that is government investments in public healthcare, and the need to make the coverage of public healthcare universal in nature in order to bring the entire poor population under its ambit. The writer also says that increased government spending in public healthcare will translate into quality healthcare for the masses only if its coverage is universal in nature. To illustrate this point, he draws a comparison between the public healthcare system of the United States and the public healthcare system of the United Kingdom. See, the United States, whose GDP is many times higher than India, spends more than 15% of its GDP on public healthcare. But this is largely in the form of insurance-based private medicine, which again increases out-of-pocket expenditure, especially for the poor population. So as a result, even though the US government spends considerably higher on healthcare, its healthcare indices are lower than many European countries. But in the United Kingdom, if you look at the government-funded National Health Service, it not only accounts for large government investments in public healthcare, but it is also universal in nature, and this is translated into better health outcomes in the United Kingdom. In fact, the same argument holds true for a number of West European countries as well. So for India, the writer says that it is not only essential for increasing government spending on public healthcare, but it is also essential to make its coverage universal in nature. Now let's take up a column from page number 7, which has been written by Mr. R.K. Raghavan, who happens to be the former director of the Central Bureau of Investigation. In this column, the writer evaluates the role of the political leadership in excesses that are committed by the police forces, and he analyzes how the political narrative that is prevalent in the society can promote the police to abuse their power. This column has been written in the context of the killing of African American George Floyd by white police officers in the United States and the massive anti-racism protests that the incident has triggered in the United States and as well as around the world. See, political scientists and sociologists have always studied the various biases that exist in the policing system. These studies have always shown that the bias that is prevalent in the policing system is a reflection of the bias that is present in the society and as well as in the political narrative. This policing bias could be on the basis of any ground. It could be on the basis of race, it could be on the basis of religion, it could be on the basis of caste or class, etc. These biases vary from country to country, from society to society, but studies have always shown that the bias in the policing system is always against the minorities. For example, in the United States, in Europe, in Australia and in New Zealand, the policing system is known to be biased against the black minorities. Studies have shown that a disproportionate number of blacks are arrested or killed by white officers in these countries. Studies have also shown how suspects are treated differently depending on whether he is a white or a black. In these countries, especially in the United States, if you look at the percentage of under trials, the percentage of convicts, the percentage of people who have been served the death penalty, a majority of them happen to be from the black minority. In the case of India, a similar bias exists in the policing system, but on the grounds of religion, caste and class. Various studies have shown that a large percentage of under trials and convicts happen to be from weaker sections and minority groups, such as Muslims, the poor population, tribal communities, etc. Studies have also conclusively proven that this does not mean that minorities are committing more crimes as compared to the majority. This just means that the policing system is more biased against the minorities and it tends to use disproportionate force while dealing with the other class of citizens. Whenever such incidents of police excess or abuse of power by the police acquires the limelight, protests do take place in India and as well as in the other countries. In most of the cases, protesters would be calling for police reforms. In the case of the United States, that is with regard to the killing of George Floyd, there has been a demand to defund the police and to restructure the police organization itself. But what we fail to acknowledge is the fact that the bias in the policing system is a reflection of the bias in the political narrative. So the writer says that in case of such incidents, while we are trying to hold the police accountable, we are failing to hold the political class, that is the political leadership, accountable. Because these biases that are prevalent in our societies has been deliberately encouraged and sustained by the political class. In the case of India, various commissions and committees have clearly recognized the excessive politicization of our police forces. This matter has been studied by various committees, including the National Police Commission or the Dharamveer Commission, the Second Administrative Reforms Commission, and this issue has been addressed by the Model Police Act and as well as by the Supreme Court in the landmark Prakash Singh case. All these commissions, committees, and these cases have examined how excessive politicization of our police forces can influence biases in the police force and how they can promote inefficiency in the policing system. See, in a democratic setup, it is true that the police force should be placed under the direct command of the political executive and the police force should be held accountable by the political executive. But this does not mean the system should create an opportunity for excessive political interference in the functioning of our police forces. Especially in countries such as India, the excessive politicization of our police forces results in these biases in being instilled in our police forces as well. Ideally, a police force has to be neutral as far as ideology, values, and political issues are concerned. But more often than not, police forces also get influenced by the biases prevalent in the political narrative. And this is the reason why the writer makes an argument that whenever such police excesses are committed and whenever there is an abuse of power by the police force, the political leadership should also be held accountable. And hence, what we need is wide-sweeping police reforms that would allow the police force to maintain its autonomy and independence from the political executive while still being placed under its direct command. The writer says that in case of such abuse of power, the role of the political leadership needs to be studied and the political leadership needs to be held accountable in order to effect true change through police reforms. Now let's take up another column from page number 7, which evaluates the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on our response to climate change. See, right now, governments around the world, private businesses, and even individuals are all concerned about the economic impact of the pandemic. Hence, their primary focus is to revive growth and development at any cost. But the question is, would these development policies take our focus away from climate change and environment conservation? The writer says that there are two ways in which the pandemic can determine our response to climate change in the future. One, we can treat the pandemic as an opportunity and work towards remodeling our economies and societies. Such a remodeling can make our economic policies more environment friendly. And this opportunity could enable the government, the private businesses, and the civil society to remodel our economy and make it more resilient towards natural disasters. It could enable them to adopt economic policies that can help reduce emissions. And at a more individual level, the pandemic might provide us an opportunity to adopt behavioral changes in our day-to-day life, which will end up reducing our impact on the environment. But on the other hand, the pandemic could also mean a lost decade for environment conservation and climate change. Because see, as a result of the pandemic and the lockdown, the finances of governments and the private sector around the world has come under a lot of strain. Their urgent priority is to revive economic growth and to revive industrial activities at any cost. So the urgency with which governments are trying to revive the economy and the lack of funds with governments and private businesses might force them to shift their focus away from environment conservation and climate change and invest entirely on the promotion of economic and industrial activities. So according to the writer, this second outcome could be disastrous for the environment and as well as for the well-being of mankind in the future. So in this context, the writer is asking the government, the NGOs and think tanks to come up with such economic policies that blends and integrates the priorities of environment conservation and climate change as well. He is basically calling for a marriage between economic and growth policies and environmental outcomes. He says that developmental policies that integrate environmental concerns are the best way forward in order to turn the pandemic into an opportunity and make our economy and society more resilient towards natural disasters and encourage behavioral changes both at the institutional level and at the personal level in order to reduce our emissions. For example, the writer says that the government could give a greater push for the manufacturing of solar equipment and electric cars. Such initiatives can not only help revive industrial activities and protect jobs, but it will also help in blending and integrating environmental priorities and climate change priorities into our economic policies. Now let's take up an article from page number 11. The Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change has come out with a new set of guidelines for the better regulation and monitoring of the import and export of exotic life species. See, as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, there has been a lot of focus on illegal wildlife trade and its connection with zoonotic diseases. Because illegal trade in wildlife species is known to result in the import of infectious zoonotic diseases into the country. So in order to better regulate the import and export of exotic life species, the MOEF has come out with a new set of guidelines wherein the importer has to voluntarily make a disclosure and obtain a no objection certificate or an NOC from the concerned authorities. This restriction on the import of exotic life species is in line with the CITES Convention. See, the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species regulates the trade of endangered animals and plants by classifying them into three appendices. International trade of animals and plants listed under Appendix 1 is completely prohibited, and exemptions are given only for scientific studies, provided if the required clearances are obtained. Whereas animals and plants that have been listed under Appendix 2 can be traded internationally, but through a licensing mechanism through which clearance certificates have to be obtained from the concerned authorities. Then under Appendix 3, countries can request the convention to include few specific animals and plants that are threatened in their region through international trade. So India's Ministry of Environment and Forest has come out with a new set of guidelines which is in line with the CITES Convention in order to regulate and monitor the import of exotic life species into India. See, these restrictions of the Environment Ministry defines what is an exotic species. As per this definition, any animal or plant which has been moved from its original range and introduced into a new habitat qualifies to be known as an exotic species. But the new guidelines of the Environment Ministry will specifically apply for animals that have been placed under Appendix 1, 2 and 3 of the CITES Convention. So the objective of the Environment Ministry is to specifically regulate the import of exotic live animals which could possibly introduce zoonotic diseases into India. And also remember that the species that have already been listed under the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, they cannot be traded. So the new guidelines expands the scope of this regulation, and it helps in regulating the import of specified live animals into India. These guidelines are expected to improve the screening and monitoring of such imports, because earlier these imports were happening under the Director General of Foreign Trade without keeping the state forest departments in the loop. So henceforth, according to the new guidelines, before an importer imports an exotic live animal into India through the DGFT, he needs to obtain a clearance, that is a no objection certificate, from the concerned state forest departments. He needs to make a voluntary disclosure to the chief wildlife warden and obtain the necessary clearance certificates. And as per these new guidelines, those who already possess an existing stock of exotic live animals that have been imported earlier, they need to make a voluntary declaration to the chief wildlife warden that discloses their existing stock. Now let's take up an article from page number 15 that helps us understand what is Border Adjustment Tax or BAT. See, currently the goods that are imported into the country, they are levied a customs duty at the port of entry in order to raise the cost of imports and provide a level playing field for the goods that are produced by the domestic industries. So on similar lines, Border Adjustment Tax is a tax that is levied in addition to the customs duty on imported goods in order to further create a level playing field for the domestic industries. The member of Niti Aayog, Mr. V.K. Saraswat, has made a case for Border Adjustment Tax because according to him, currently domestic goods are at a disadvantage as compared to imported goods. He says that goods that are produced domestically, they incur a variety of taxes such as electricity duty, the mandi tax, clean energy cess, royalty, etc. And according to him, the imposition of these taxes on domestically produced goods makes them uncompetitive as compared to the cheaper imported goods. He says that the current customs duty being imposed on imported goods is not sufficient to create a level playing field, and hence he has made a case for the imposition of Border Adjustment Tax on imported goods in order to protect the domestic industry. Now let's take up the practice questions for the day. The first batch of Indian indentured laborers were transported to which country? The correct answer is option C, Mauritius. This question has been asked because the 100 years ago article from page number 7 makes a reference to an interview with Mr. C.F. Andrews, who is speaking about the discrimination faced by Indian indentured laborers in Africa. See, in 1833, the British Parliament abolished slavery, and this ended the dependency of British colonies and British capitalists on African slaves. So the abolition of slavery created a need for British industrialists to find cheap labor, and they came out with an alternative system that is known as the indentured labor system. This was essentially a type of bonded labor which was designed to exploit poor Indians, and under this system they were transported from British India to British colonies around the world, and they were forced to work in sugar plantations, agricultural fields and various industries owned by the British capitalists. The first batch of such Indian indentured laborers were transported to Mauritius, which is located in the Indian Ocean region and a part of the African continent, in the year 1834. The day the first batch of indentured laborers from India landed in Mauritius is still celebrated as the Apravasi Day, in order to commemorate the close cultural and people-to-people relations between India and Mauritius. The site where the first batch of indentured laborers landed at Port Louis has been turned into a memorial known as the Apravasi Ghat, and it is a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Over the years, lakhs of Indians were transported to Mauritius under the indentured labor system, and this goes on to explain why a majority of the population of Mauritius is of Indian origin. Under the same system, the British transported millions of Indians to various British colonies, including Fiji, various countries in Latin America, in Africa, and in the Caribbean. This is the reason why, even to this day, these countries have a large population of Indian origin. And C.F. Andrews happens to be a very important figure in India's national movement. He was a Christian missionary from England, and he worked towards the upliftment of poor Indians in Africa and as well as in British India. Later, he became a close confidant of Mahatma Gandhi and even Rabindranath Tagore, and he also played a key role in motivating Mahatma Gandhi to move to India from South Africa and lead India's freedom struggle by drawing upon his experience from fighting for Indian laborers in South Africa. It was Mahatma Gandhi who gave C.F. Andrews the popular nickname Dinabandhu in recognition of his work towards the poor labor class. Now let's take up the next practice question. The International Religious Freedom Report is published by the US State Department. Option C is the right answer. This question has been asked because according to this article on page number 10, the US State Department has released its annual International Religious Freedom Report, in which it expresses concern about rising incidents of cow vigilantism and mob violence in India. This report also expresses concern about the Citizenship Amendment Act, the National Register of Citizens, and it goes on to highlight the declining religious freedom in India. A couple of months ago, the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom, which is an independent commission of the US government, had also expressed similar concerns, and it had downgraded India to a country of particular concern, which happens to be the lowest category as far as religious freedom is concerned. These observations of the US Commission on International Religious Freedom and the findings of the International Religious Freedom Report of the US State Department has always been opposed by the Indian government, and the government has accused the organization and the report of being biased against India, and it has labeled them as allegations that are geopolitically motivated. Now let's take up the next practice question. The Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act of 1974 provided for the establishment of the Central Pollution Control Board, the National Green Tribunal, or the National Biodiversity Authority. The correct answer is option A, one only. The Water Act established the Central Pollution Control Board, and it created an institutional structure to combat water pollution. This legislation also provided a framework for the establishment of the state pollution control boards. Later, when the Air Act was passed in 1981, the responsibility of combating air pollution was also entrusted to the same institutional architecture headed by the Central Pollution Control Board at the national level and the state pollution control boards at the state level. This question has been asked because according to this article on page number 10, As per the directions of the National Green Tribunal, the CPCB will be classifying the railway stations into the red, orange and green category based on the quality of wastewater that is generated. This is as per the directions of the NGT, which had directed the Indian Railways to obtain a no objection certificate from the CPCB as per the provisions of the Water Act and the Air Act. Now let's take up a practice question from the 2019 prelims paper. Consider the following pairs. On one side, we have threatened species of wildlife, and on the other hand, we have a list of habitats where they might be found. So we need to check whether these pairs are correctly matched. First, we have blue-finned mahseer, which has been matched with the Kaveri River, the Irrawaddy dolphin matched with the Chambal River, and the rusty spotted cat matched with Eastern Ghats. Amongst the given pairs, the second pair is incorrectly matched. So the correct answer is option C, 1 and 3 only. See, the Irrawaddy dolphin is found in the coastal areas of South Asia and Southeast Asia. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question, discuss the habitat, range, distribution and conservation status of Asiatic lions with emphasis on threats faced by the species. The second question, understanding the role of the political leadership in police excesses is crucial to effect change. Critically analyze. Kindly write an answer to these questions and post your answers in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.